So there are four different reasons or factors that contributed to the unbalanced sex ratios in China. First is the long-run preference for having sons relative to having daughters. And second and the third are the policy changes that started in 1979 and also early 1980s. These are the famous family planning policy, that's the so-called one-child policy, as well as the rural land reform. And lastly was due to the availability of the ultrasound technology. And this technical advancement made the sex selection feasible at the lower cost. So there has been a long tradition or long-run culture of preferring sons than having daughters because of several reasons. In the past, China relies a lot on the agricultural production, and males have higher productivity than females in the agricultural sector. And second reason was due to the tradition of patrilocal residence in China. So when parents get old, they would usually live with the sons and they would not live with daughters. So sons would take care of parents in their old age, but daughters will move out of the natal family and join the family of the in-laws or the husband, and she will take care of the in-laws. And second reason for the unbalanced sex ratios was due to the one-child policy. So to reinforce the compliance of the birth quota, enormous fines were exposed to couples who exceeded the birth quota. So this basically increased the opportunity cost of couples having the child of the unwanted sex. So if they have a daughter, then basically to have another son, then they have to pay a lot of fines in order to make it possible. And there is one thing which needs to be noticed here with the one-child policy. Although from the name, the policy seems to only allow for one child per couple, but that's not always the case in China. So for example, in the rural area after the mid-1980s, the couples were allowed to have a second birth if the firstborn was a daughter. And also this one-child policy does not apply to the couples belonging to the minor ethnicity, because a minority group in China makes up a very small portion of the huge population. The third reason for the unbalanced sex ratios was due to the rural land reform. So this rural land reform is also called the household responsibility system that shifted the incentive of agricultural production from the collective side to the household side. So after this reform, the households, they have higher pressure of increasing the agricultural production. As we know that males, they have higher productivity than females in agriculture. And then the households, they would prefer a stronger preference of having sons compared to having daughters. So all these three either historically persisting cultural norms or the two policy changes, they have only made the motivation of sex selection stronger. And the fourth factor which contributed to the unbalanced sex ratios made the sex selection feasible at a lower cost. The ultrasound technology made it possible for the couples to test the sex of the child during the pregnancy. This test is at low cost, and thus more and more couples in China choose to choose the prenatal selection through abortion or other surgeries. And these four factors have led to the unbalanced sex ratios in China. So there are two types of marriage payments in China. One is bride price, the other one is the dowry. So the bride price is paid from the male side to the female side at the time of marriage, and dowry is paid from the female side to the male side. The bride prices are usually paid by the male and also his own parents, and is paid usually to the female's daughter, but sometimes it's also paid to the new family. But dowries are usually paid by the female's parents only, and then it's usually paid given to daughter, and then the daughter would bring the asset into the new household. But of course, there are also exceptions. So the value of bride prices is decided through the negotiation before the marriage. So it's negotiated between the female's parents and also the male's parents. But dowry's value is not negotiated and is given totally voluntarily. It depends on the female's parents, how much they're willing to give to the daughter. So there are, regarding the motivations of the marriage payments in China, firstly, we need to notice that bride prices are usually expected to be paid out at the time of marriage, due to the Chinese norms and traditions. So the payment of bride prices is usually a sign that this marriage is formalized and legalized in the society. But dowries are paid out more on a voluntary basis. And there has been studies showing that dowries could be a function as a pre-mortem inheritance. So because due to the Chinese tradition, the females, when they get married, then they basically leave the natal family and join the family of the husband. When the parents die, then the daughters could not inherit the household assets anymore. For sure, right now it's changing, but by giving out some money or assets to daughters upon marriage, has been a long-run tradition or norms, but it has never been compulsory required by the society. And also, in China, the old age care infrastructure is incomplete, and parents still rely a lot on the children for the old age care. And in a lot of times, the bride prices and dowries, they are paid out by parents as an implicit intergenerational contract. So from the data, I have found that by paying out dowries, parents are more likely to receive monetary transfer, care, and also help in their old age from those daughters who have received dowries compared to those daughters who haven't received dowries. Lastly, bride prices and dowries, since most of the money is paid out by parents, it could just be a signal for the parents' affection and love, and is not attached to any rewards or any functions in the society. So in China, the highest male-to-female sex ratios were found in the economically less developed area. For example, in rural area, the sex ratios were higher than the urban area. And also the sex ratios were higher in the middle part of China and the western part of China compared to the eastern coastal part of China. So these were found using the nationally representative data collected from 2010 to 2016, as well as from the publicly available census data collected in the 2000. The reason behind could be due to the gender profile in the internal migration. So there has been studies finding that females compared to males are more likely to leave the economically depressed areas. So there has been empirical studies found out that the male surplus and unbalanced sex ratios has led to higher unmarried rate of the males, especially for the males with lower socioeconomic status. This is also easy to understand because when females become scarce, then they have higher, there would be higher marriage sorting. So they would always pick the males of better quality, which means that they will pick the males with higher education or more wealthy ones. This has also caused a problem in the crime rate in the society, because imagine in places where there is a high male surplus and many males are left as single, they don't have a family, they don't have children, so they can't really settle down. And the local crime rates was also found to be higher. But there are also positive effects on the society. For example, the high male surplus also leads to higher competition among males to seek for a wife. And this higher pressure has caused them to engage in higher risky economic activities. For example, in the places where there is a higher local sex ratio, then the entrepreneurial activities in that village is also higher, so that this also has a positive impact on the economic growth. On the other side, the parents of the males would also feel a pressure because continuing the lineage of the family is of extreme importance for the Chinese Chinese tradition. And it's found that in places where there are too many males but too few females, the households would increase the savings rate because they would like to increase the status of the males or their sons in the marriage market. So in another research paper of mine, we have found that the male surplus has also impacted the socioeconomic effects of the higher housing price growth in China. So there has been a substantial growth of housing prices since 2004 in China. And many people would think, well, if the houses are just too expensive to buy, why don't people rent a home? And this is in China. This is because the competition among males in the marriage market has been so high that they would have a pressure to buy an even more expensive or luxury housing in order to increase their attractiveness in the marriage market for a wife. And we have found that such a higher housing price growth has a strong gender profile, that females were not affected by the housing price growth, but males experienced a negative socioeconomic impact. And there is also an intergenerational spillover, that parents with sons or with unmarried adult sons would also experience a negative socioeconomic impact as well. In another research work of mine, I have found that this male surplus has a substantial impact on the bride prices in China. So bride prices are paid out from the male side to the female side at the time of marriage. And in China, I found that when there is higher surplus of males to females, then more people would pay bride prices, and also the average value of bride prices paid out is would be higher. In the 2000, the average bride prices paid out is about 15,000 Chinese yuan. That's about 2,000 euros. But in 2010, the average value of bride prices paid out has been about 40,000 Chinese yuan. That's about 5,000 euros. So the average bride prices paid out has more than doubled over the past 10 years. And this has already adjusted for inflation. This has caused a huge financial burden for the household. Moreover, there are also some qualitative evidence that this has caused the gender crimes and also discrimination. So from the data, from a nationally representative data, I have found that both bride prices and dowries are increasing. So it means that since the 21st century, more people are paying bride prices, and also more people are paying dowries. And also the average value of bride prices is increasing, but also the average value of dowries is also increasing. So about the long run of trend of marriage payments, it has actually been found that with economic development and modernization, the marriage payments would gradually disappear. So this has been observed in Europe, in Latin America, and also Sub-Saharan Africa. And I think in my personal point of view, the function of bride prices serving as a signal of formalizing or legalizing the marriage, this would be weakened with economic development and also modernization. About the negative impact of the bread prices in China, firstly and most importantly, it has worsened the socioeconomic inequality in the society, because most of the men which are left who are left unmarried, they are of the lower socioeconomic status, and these people, they are excluded, or basically they are the losers of the fierce competition among males in the marriage market. And secondly, this high bread prices has also directly imposed a huge financial burden for the households with sons.